You're listening to a dancing pig to a deduction pig to a deduction pig to a deduction pig to a deduction pig to a deduction.
World of Smith by Clive Gilson. Book 1, beginning with Smith. Tales of creation vary according to time and place in any given universe, and yet, when you hear those dusty tales, it is the similarities between them that strike you the most, and from these similarities we assume that there must at least be a grain of truth shared amongst our stories of beginning. For example, most such tales share an idea or thought of conception that is usually expressed as an action of some form of anthropomorphic being. The lists of creators are legion. In the Bakuba account, the earth was originally nothing but water and darkness, ruled by the giant Mbombo. This giant, after feeling an intense pain in his stomach one day, vomited up the sun, moon, and stars. For the Maasai of Kenya, humanity was fashioned by the creator from a single tree or leg which split into three pieces. Beyond the rising Maasai sun, the Ainu people of Hokkaido tell of six heavens and six hells where gods, demons, and animals lived. In the highest of these heavens lived Kamui, the creator god, and his servants. In the bloody annals of Aztec narratives, creation proceeds with an earth mother, Coatlicue, the lady of the skirt of snakes. Not all tales of creation begin with the action or thought of some vaguely familiar being. Although some philosophers of origin may hear such abstracts as nothing more than a little local dissent or muddled thinking, nonetheless these different tales can be just as powerful. In earlier Vedic pondering on origin, the universe emanated from a cosmic egg, while some Taoists interpreted creation as a series of philosophical steps. The way gave birth to unity. Unity gave birth to duality. Duality gave birth to Trinity. And Trinity gave birth to the myriad creatures. Buddhism, however, largely ignores the question. The Buddha is quoted as saying something like, "Conjecture about the world is an unconjecturable that is not to be conjectured about. That would bring madness and vexation to anyone who conjectured about it." Allowing for the unknowable and the agnostic, tolerating the conflict between the absolute void and the essential necessity of beginning, and forgetting for a moment the clamour of insistent insanity that underpins all of our attempts to understand anything beyond the obvious demarcation lines of our own fragile and brief existence, the tale that follows may also turn out to be as much a truth about creation as any other. It is a commonly held belief that where there is light, there must be darkness. That forces of life are matched by those of death, and that in all things there is a balanced equation of equals and opposites. It stands to basic human reasoning, given that we as conscious beings experience everything through a beginning and an end. A human child is born, erupts through puberty, mellows in maturity, fades with age, and eventually returns to the dust of death. A washing machine rises bright and shining from its packaging, suffers a decade of high-speed revolutions and hot water calcification, and finally returns back to its constituent elements through recycling or decomposition deep beneath the gulf-strewn summits of landfill. This limitation to life is, of course, entirely human-centric and bears no real scrutiny when we consider the true faith inherent in origin. What was out there before Big Bang? The question is answerable only by an apparently endless circling of the square root of our own experience, or by accepting that there is an absolute version of an almost impossible conceptual device. Nothing. The deity in question in this story was and is a small god. He, she, or it has, by simply existing, removed the possibility of nothing. But equally, none of the fundamental questions about beginning are answered by this god's existence. We have to face the simple fact that there was, all along, something. In this particular beginning, there was darkness, an almost void, an incomplete essence, and for the sake of simplicity, Smith, our quietly drifting creator, really rather liked the darkness. Smith was the way and the meaning of nothing. Smith was thought without action, the procrastination at the very start of things. Smith liked to drift in the great expanse of unplace, whiling away the immeasurable eons of non-time by contemplating the vagueness at the heart of imagined worlds and stars and angels. Smith was not by nature solitary, rather it was simply the case that he had always been alone. Smith had what we would recognise as thoughts, but he had no shapes upon which to hang them. Smith was unable to fashion physical angels and demons as companions, because Smith had never imagined imagination. In effect, Smith could draw like an 18-month-old infant. He had no control over the heavenly pencil. All that Smith was aware of was the equivalent of a cosmic itch and in the impotence inherent in not quite understanding the concept of the scratch. Smith unwittingly agreed with the future earthly Buddha in that he found the unformulated conjecture of eternal peace to be vexatious and maddening. There is a moment in every natural state, a moment before the reaction, when forces are marshalled, reach a critical point, and then tip towards change. Across the far-flung boundaries of the void, Smith finally determined that the endlessly irritating sensation that underlay the void was deserving of a name. Smith thought through the very fabric of time, and finally, in a moment of naturally divine inspiration, he called the itch silence. Silence was the first form, the first shape upon which Smith could hang an idea. And he marvelled at the universe that crept into view with the naming of this first idea. Silence was a perfection of void and nothing. Smith, using a modern colloquial term, loved silence. But with love comes an inevitable discontent. Even in the vast emptiness of Smith time, the itch eventually returned, and Smith was forced to concede a fundamental philosophical point. In order that Smith might truly enjoy the silence, in the same way that a man might enjoy the silence of a house in the early morning before the space in the world is filled with voices, he had to accept the fact that he, she, or it, was conceptually awake. To love silence, Smith realized, meant that the Creator had become aware of self and place and time, and of the difference between places and times and selves, none of which could ever have existed in a true void. Smith thought, and in thinking proved Descartes right, and therein lay a problem. He was alone. He saw darkness. He experienced silence. He felt need. Smith wanted something, but had no means to express such things in any sense other than silence and darkness. And so, Smith thought unshapes out of the fraying circular cords of absolute tranquility. Beyond the confines of Earth time, way out beyond the fringes of the galaxy where dark matter falls forever, Smith thought about nothing, taking slow but gigantic steps towards origin. And in thinking, even on a universal scale, Smith began to acquire the very first trappings of personality. Universal silence had a shape, and the simple fact that Smith could hang thoughts from this shape inevitably led him to choose particular ways of thinking. Smith preferred those thought shapes that pleased, that scrapped the cosmic itch most effectively, and so he expressed thought in a set of patterned, reactive ways. Smith started to become predictable. Predictability was, thought Smith, in a broad and universal manner, a good thing. Smith preferred to consider a thought from a familiar set of viewpoints, rolling it across the heavens like thunder, looking at all those aspects of silence and darkness that reinforced the heavens as imagined by a responsible God. No matter how hard he tried to order creation, however, he continually discovered unwelcome shades of black within the unlimited spaces of the void, and in so doing, he revealed even more of a personality. Smith liked some shades of nothing more than others. Smith put away the shades that displeased, and so came the formation of an idea that later we would call good and bad. unlike our earthly translators of the divine, unlike our latter-day messengers of God who know the way and speak the truth in our narrowly confined little world, Smith continually refashioned his likes and dislikes. With every turn of thought, as the shades of dark void rippled in the non-light, Smith found that his tastes changed. What had once been a good shade now became a bad tone, and vice versa. Smith found choice. Silence has a shape, and upon that shape hang thoughts, and thoughts ripple, and Smith's universal mind grappled with the meaning of things without words or explanation. Faced with an endlessly moving target of certainty, it is probably little wonder that across the gulf of time and space, Smith became a little indecisive. With such unlimited options within the darkness, how could a simple, artisan, pubescent god make a choice? We, the readers of books and tales, find it difficult enough to answer questions, even when our reading is wide and our thinking deep. For Smith, without access to heaven's libraries, the darkness was beauty beyond description. Solitude was a cruel mistress who only ever tasked without instruction. And silence was the wonder, the brilliance, the radiance of an eternal symphony half remembered. Smith could never quite be sure of anything. Silence was bliss, was the summation of every force and vitality known to the universal mind. But the inevitably subtle tonal difference within that quietude, as with the spectral shades of the void, caused Smith to vacillate. In human terms, Smith listened to silence like we listen to Mozart on a Tuesday. We love Mozart the best. Then we listen to Beethoven on a Thursday and love Beethoven the best. Smith loved the universal light program that fizzed across the unseen radiation waves of his thought. But he loved each and every aspect of silence as if, for a fleeting moment, it was the only silence he had ever heard. Smith took the melody and the rhythm of the void into the soul of creation, swinging in allegiance from every note to every other note in a crescendo of perfect solitude, until it began to dawn on Smith that there was simply no way to settle on a universal truth in unsound. And so it came to pass, always the sign of an author who can't quite grasp the deepest philosophical foundations, let alone be bothered to write it all down. It came to pass that Smith, in the madness of endless conjecture, decided to stick a virtual pin into the dark hide of the universal donkey. Smith drew a metaphorical line in the cosmic sand, and, breaking with every one of the unbidden traditions that had as yet underpinned the universe, thought spoke to the void.
Let there be light.
Smith allowed the melody of sudden voice to flood through the vacuum of the void, combining it with the driving bass line of fundamental creation that beat at his breast. And in so doing, the stars shone suddenly like notes upon a black stave. Smith squinted in the bursting light, rubbed the black holes at the heart of his consciousness, and grinned. The music of the heavens filled Smith with delight, and he swooned with every rising phrase, letting the maelstrom notes burn through the void. Had the universe contained any concept as simple as song, you would have heard Smith sing with a booming voice.
Let there be galaxies, let there be gases, let there be collisions between heavenly bodies, let there be strange and squiggly chemical chain reactions.
This is how the heavens broke forth into starlight, how the sun begins to burn, and how the cosmic gas and dust coalesce to form the planets. This is how a primordial soup was brewed, how tectonic shifts came to be, and how the rocks and the heaving skies settled down to their endless game of birth and erosion. Smith looked out across these symphonic landscapes and grinned ever wider. And it was good. Except, of course, for the unbending equation, for the balancing highs and lows in the song of Smith's stars. For things to be good, for Smith to feel the warmth of a billion billion nuclear suns, there also had to be things that were bad. There had to be the absolute cold, that allowed Smith to feel the warmth. And the inevitable balancing factor in the equation was Smith. In the primordial soup of creation, a chemical chain might have a lifetime of a second, or it might exist in an unbroken sequence that lasted for millennia. But for Smith, that moment of absolute happiness in the melody of life was nothing but a blink of an eye. Smith looked down upon one small star, and upon one totally insignificant rocky ball at the outer edge of a tiny spiral galaxy of stars, and there he heard the very first bum note. If, along with suns, molten planet cores and gas nebulae, Smith had invented teeth, then he would have understood the problem instinctively. This single second of discord in Act 3 of the Universal Symphony effectively scratched a single fingernail of blackboard agony across Smith's infant mind. And he knew, in that instant of molar-grinding pain, that the equation must have balance. Good requires bad. Smith looked down upon the third rock out from a brightly burning star at the edge of an insignificant spiral galaxy and beheld friction. The elemental soup eroded the rock. Skies billowed and poured acid rain into fissures in those rocks, fissures that cracked and split ever wider. And spellbound by the fascination that makes a B-movie actress in a horror film go forth to see what it is that makes such an unusual noise, Smith made his first fundamental mistake. Gods, even small ones, should never delegate. But if you read the stories in any one of a thousand books, you will find that pretty well every single one of these creative types has taken the odd shortcut or two. Smith thought about the bad, considered the symphonic disagreement at the edge of the universe, and, after a millennium or two of orbital time, Smith arrived at a conclusion. The solution was simple and elegant. Take a galactic eraser, rub out the errant note, and write down a simple harmonic improvement. However, feeling the pull of a billion stars, feeling the weight of mass and time upon his shoulders, succumbing to the myriad energies of relative balance flexing across the void, Smith put away the cosmic HB pencil with the little pink tip, washed his hands in the ethereal mists of space, and willed the skies to peace. Smith brushed the primordial broth with a thought, dismissing this disappointing barren little rock with a shrug, and left the madly sparkling chemical squiggles to their own peculiar frenzy of oxygenated radicalism. Almost as an afterthought, Smith allocated a small portion of his dream time as the equivalent of a galactic closed-circuit television system. That part of his ethereal mind that bore the as-yet-unnamed form of conscience added just a hint of chiding harmonic resonance to the song of the universe, and thus was born the conduit between God and the third rock from an insignificant little star. Smith turned his gaze away from the chemical and physical experiment at the edge of what we now call the Milky Way, but he left the monitors on and the tapes running, just in case he ever needed to put a face to a crime. In doing this, in leaving the cameras on constant surveillance, Smith also effected a process of change and evolution. As Smith dreamed and experimented and changed the fabric of time and space, as he formulated infinite varieties of life and death across the vast expanse of the void, small packages of his thought leaked out from beyond the horizon of Smith's dreaming, and drifted over the aeons along the canals and wires that connect the universe whole. Some of these rogue thoughts leaked into the here and now, drifting all the way out to Smith's now forgotten Song of the Earth. In dreaming of a peacock sky on some far distant world, Smith allowed a feather to fall upon the barren rocks of our world. Cells coalesced as notes in the song combined. Water formed as notes tumbled over cosmic cliff edges, and proverbial butterfly wings fluttered in their thousands over the future distant space of Beijing. Amphibians croaked a tenor's song of night. The unicorn fluttered into the world for an instant before the nightmare broke its back upon the anvil. Clouds billowed. Rain fell. Mountains rose and rivers cut deep scars into the surface of the planet. Ferns uncurled their leaves, morphosing into a billion species of tree and bush and flower. A flood of marine shapes colonized the roaring seas. Monsters roamed the earth, shaking the foundations of the world to rubble. And finally, in the heart of blackness, that was a shallow echo of Smith's loneliness, there was a dream of companionship. The mammals came, and one of them, born of just a single microscopic moment in the great dream, stood up and walked out from the crowd. Through the long ages of Smith's indifference, the madly spinning earth flourished, blooming on the edge of the void like a tiny fungal spore at the heart of a vast, immeasurable forest. And in that paradisiacal garden, the ape walked, simply and silently, embodying the dream of Smith, becoming the ultimate, if yet unknown, companion. Birdsong joined with the universal melody. Volcanoes added deep resonance to the bass lines underpinning the twinkling of the stars. Whales sang in the deeps of the ocean. Life itself, upon, within, and underneath the good, damp soil, blew a fanfare to the heavens far beyond the measure of any single organism. The song was good, and Smith, even though he heard none of the individual songs sung by the flora and fauna of his long-forgotten refrain at the edge of all things, found contentment in the straightforward knowledge that the song continued, a fulfilment sufficient to think the work of creation a noble thing. But as always with the rhythm of the universe, a discordant note took its inevitable place in the skirl of creation. Smith battered the discord away like a fly on a hot summer day, but no matter how swift or firm Smith's vast and unimaginable hand, the fly continually evaded the swatter and buzzed back and forth at the edge of his perception. Eventually, Smith turned towards the high-pitched whine of gossamer-winged song and, looking behind the metaphorical net curtain that hid the outer reaches of the old melodies from hearing, Smith focused his universal ear upon the sound of this disharmony. Out at the edge of an insignificantly flat spiral galaxy, by a minute speck of light that shone almost below the visible spectrum, Smith heard plaintive howling. Looking down upon the bright and savage earth for the first time in countless measures of eternity, Smith saw something quite unexpected. The utterly familiar shape of loneliness, embodied in the outlandish shell of the hairless ape who dared to contemplate creation, baying at the stars, calling out in utter desperation for the companionship that comes with that first sparkling moment of harmony within the Song of Songs.
This podcast is copyright Clive Gilson, 2011. For more information about my podcasts and to find out where you can download them in full as audio files, please visit my website, www.clivegilson.com, where you can also find free samples that you can enjoy at your leisure. For now, though, that's it from this particular broadcast, so take care, and I'll catch up with you soon. Bye for now. You're listening to a dancing pig, to a dancing pig, to a dancing pig, to a dancing pig, to a dancing pig.